hydropower. So we have a reasonably large amount of energy coming in from here, and very useful, always been useful. There are problems here. So what are the problems? Problems. A. Dams. Okay, dams cause a lot of problem. First of all, you can't make the dams in all the places. So there is a limit to the places where you can make the dams. Then, as the dams are made, they submerge large areas of land, large in water areas of land in water. That means land is covered with water permanently, a large area of land, because the dams which are built around that area. And that is why near Tehri, the whole town of Tehri is submerged because of the dam which was made there. So we pay a huge price that the people have to be shifted. Those people who had their houses there and they had their jobs there, their life there, all these people have to be migrating to other places. And you can imagine for thousands and thousands of people what a big problem it is. Where do you relocate them? How do you give them houses? How do you give them jobs? Right? So all these problems come up. So when you submerge, it creates problem with the human beings, and it creates a problem with the animal life. Even the animals, of course, a lot of them die, or they run away to various places where they don't have enough fodder, not enough security to live peacefully. And the worst thing is the flora and fauna, right? The agriculture gets totally destroyed, or the forest life, agricultural life, or the forest life is totally destroyed. The ecosystem is destroyed. Now these are very important problems, okay, because the whole natural balance is lost. When the water is submerged, there is a third problem. Methane is produced, a large amount of methane is produced, large, because the agricultural products and the forest products are rotting. So because they rot, methane is produced, and methane, unfortunately, is another gas which causes the greenhouse effect. Just like carbon dioxide, it causes greenhouse effect. So you can see the problems. You can see the problems. There are huge problems because of this hydroelectricity, which is indispensable for us. We got to have it, but we got to deal with these problems. Try to solve them as much as possible, or find some other better alternate sources. So this is renewable, okay, renewable source, I agree, but has its own problems, right, and limitations. Now, is there any possibility of technology helping out in these matters? Can we use technology to improve these conventional sources? These conventional sources, their energy, their efficiency, or the problems, can we do something with the technology to help in the conventional sources? There are a few things which can help. The first thing that one often uses in villages is very often used. Villages or smaller towns, not metros, is something called biomass. As the name suggests, it has to do with the products of humans and animals and vegetation, anything which is living. So you have the waste product. For example, you have cow dung. Okay, you have cow dung in villages, or you may have rotting vegetation, or you may have human waste. Right? This, by the way, in Hindi or in some languages, native languages, is Marathi or maybe Gujarati, is called gobar. And what we are talking about is the gobar gas, which is a very good, very hygienic, surprisingly very hygienic, very useful, very efficient way of getting a gas which burns. Now, what do we do in this? if you have, suppose, enough trees which would supply constantly wood, okay, or something like, say, rotting leaves or branches, right? So you would have a steady supply of these waste products which can be used to produce energy. So first of all, you got to have trees so that you have a steady supply of biomass to be converted into electrical energy. Now how do we do this? Okay, when it is known that when you have this, instead of using in ordinary stove or ordinary chulas, you see, the villagers use chulas and they use ovens, we call them, and we put wood in them, burn wood. It is not at all a very efficient way of getting heat energy. A lot of heat is wasted. They are very harmful gases produced, which are harmful to the lady or the men who are cooking. And therefore, that is not a very good way of using these waste supplies. So what we do is that if there is a limited supply, that's a very important thing, if they are burnt in a limited supply of oxygen, don't have a free supply of oxygen, limited supply of oxygen, then it so happens that charcoal is left behind as a residue, and some smokeless gases, higher heat amount is produced, and what happens is the gases which come out, they can be ignited. Okay, they are ignited, and this biogas then can be used to produce heat. Okay, so how is this plant made? Let us study that. Okay, so we are now studying goober gas plant, or a plant which will produce gas which can be burnt. Now what we have here is something called a digester, as it digests the waste products. Okay, so you have some kind of structure made up of bricks, and in that we have some source of waste coming in. This is the surrounding earth. We have made this with the bricks. Okay, there is a dome in the central area. This waste product which comes in, which is brought in, is called as slurry. It comes in from the from here, and from it is covered like this. So this is the slurry which is filling up the inside of the digester. Then here this is a gas tank. This is soil above this, and this is the gas tank. Okay. Now here a digester is, this is a sealed chamber in which there is hardly any oxygen. There are some microorganisms, ANAEROBIC, anaerobic microorganisms. They are there in the slurry, and if there is a shortage of oxygen, after some time, of course, initially there will be some oxygen, and then later on it will be all gone because the gas is produced, and here is an exit, an outlet for the gas. So these organisms which are there, microorganisms which are there in the slurry, what they do is they decompose the slurry or the compounds in the cow dung slurry. Now when it decomposes, it produces gases like methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen, and hydrogen sulfide. Okay, so the gas would rise naturally from the slurry, and the gas would come out from here, where it can be supplied to the homes, which can be ignited and burnt like your gas in the cylinder. Okay. Now there is a very nice advantage. The advantage, well, is that this slurry, it is collected in the form of manure, which is a kind of fertilizer. So not only you get very important, useful the gases which can be ignited, right? Not only you get a clean, efficient source of energy, you also get fertilizer. Okay, so what are the advantages of this biogas? Okay, what are the advantages? High amount of methane is obtained. It burns without smoke. So there is no smoke like the traditional chula. Then it is no useless residue. Right? What residue are we talking about? Ash. It doesn't have useless residue. Okay. The residue charcoal. Okay. These things are not there. But what is there? What you have the left behind is the stuff, is the leftover slurry. Leftover slurry is rich in nitrogen and phosphorus. Nitrogen and phosphorus compounds. And they are extremely nice as manure. And lastly, and very importantly, their efficiency, the production of heat per efficiency is high. Efficiency is high. So they are very efficient, heat capacity is high. Okay. And waste, not to be left behind. The waste disposed. You see, what did you do with the cow dung? Okay. The villagers make cakes out of those, and they are burned into chulas. So we do use that to some extent, but a lot of waste that we were talking about, which is brought here, is normally just lying like that. So, and it is not disposed. So this not only produces a large amount of gas which can be used up as heat source, it also disposes the waste. So these are very good, very useful. This is a very useful method of obtaining technologically advanced. Not much of a technology is used here, but it is better than the chulas. Okay, and it has lot of advantages.